evening and welcome to the historic Mansion House in the heart of Dublin. When tonight's guest was a little boy, he was obsessed with Michael Jackson and he decided that he wanted to become a pop star. Little did this little lad from Sligo realise that he would become a member of the biggest boy band on the planet, which sold 46 million albums and had 14 UK number ones. He made a fortune, but ended up going bankrupt, owing 23 million euro, just as the band called it a day. He's come through the toughest time in his life, lived to tell the tale, and he's still only 35. Will you welcome, please, Shane Filan. Shane, it's great to see you. I just wanted to catch up, first of all. We've an awful lot to talk about tonight, but I wanted to catch up. How's it going? What are you doing?
Right now, I'm in studio making my second album. I'm about halfway through it at the moment, so it's going really well. So I'm in a good place. I'm very excited, and I'm still singing, so it's good.
Well, as I say, we have an awful lot we want to talk about, but let's go back to where it all began in Sligo. You raise me up.
All the people I've worked with, and I've worked with a lot of people, I think Shane Filan has the most amazing voice.
Shane Filan was born in 1979, the youngest of seven. The family lived over a cafe in Sligo town run by Shane's parents, Peter and May.
He loved chatting up customers.
We often used to send him on a message and Shane might take 20 minutes before he come back, because if he saw a mirror in a window, he would start dancing and doing Michael Jackson.
Yeah, he loved Michael Jackson as a young man. Spinning kicks and all this whole thing. He'd drive around the twist.
In 1991, at the tender age of 12, Shane performed on stage for the first time.
He was using it. He knew how to use it, even at that age.
A few years later, Shane would perform Grease again, only this time alongside Keane Egan and Marcus Feely.
The first time I saw the three of those standing together, I knew this could possibly be something.
And that something turned out to be six things. Shane, Keane, Marcus and three friends who formed the band IOU.
People thought I was mad. A boy band from Sligo. I mean, come on, you know? No, not at all. That couldn't work.
We are about to go in to the next room there to do a photo shoot, and we don't know what to expect, but it looks pretty cool.
They were the worst looking band ever. They really were. Pimples, bad hair, bad clothes. They did look like six colchis.
It's going to be unbelievable.
What a good attitude. And that's what I liked. I knew we could change everything else.
I bet it brings you back.
I haven't seen that footage in 15 years. It's actually, it's crazy to watch it now. Yeah. Amazing memories.
You had actually become quite a big band around Sligo, hadn't you?
Yeah, we did. You know, Mary, when we did the... we were doing Grease, obviously, and I knew Keane and Mara from school and stuff like that. But, yeah, we had the idea of kind of going on for two songs. Mary wanted to, why don't you do it seriously? And go on for two songs at half-time. And that just, you know, that went really well. The crowd was going crazy. And we wanted to be the Backstreet Boys. We wanted to be famous. We wanted to be pop stars. And then we got to do it. We kind of did more and more shows. We started putting on more and more shows around Sligo and surrounding kind of counties. And yeah, we felt like we were the biggest band. You know, we had all our dreams come true at that stage, we thought, and obviously until we met Louis. Yeah.
Now, Mary believed in you in Sligo.
Totally.
And you had a band of six guys.
Yeah.
Only three of whom made the cut to Westlife in the end of the day. What was it that made you want to sort of get out of Sligo and get bigger? Or who was behind that move?
Well, I think getting bigger, we were six lads from Sligo, six friends from Sligo. So that whole kind of, you know, when my mum rang Louis, because she wanted to have the biggest manager in the world managing her son. You know, she was very, I suppose she was very determined and very gutsy to be able to just pick up the phone and ring him.
And what did Louis say to her when she rang?
This is May Filan from Kilshamash, she said. And she rang me that night in Dublin. I was in Dublin. And Louis, I heard she'd rang Louis, and I thought, I didn't believe her. I hung up the phone on her twice. I was like, "Ma'am, don't be daft, will you? I've been talking to Louis Walsh." She was like, "Oh, yeah." I didn't believe her. And then...
Every mother in the country might have wanted to ring up Louis. So what was her connection?
I don't know. She was from Kilshamash.
That's
enough. Thank God she was from around the corner, literally, from his family as well. So she would have known the family growing up. So I think, you know, Louis would have got 100 phone calls a day, you know, but for some reason he took this call and he just picked up the phone in his office. It's usually Denise that answers his office, but it was him. He goes, "Hello," you know, and that was it. And I just go into Louis' impressions too often. he took the phone call, and kind of from then on, like literally within a few weeks, we were supporting the Backstreet Boys. He got us supporting the Backstreet Boys in the RDS. And from that, it really snowballed very quickly. And then he wanted to manage us.
Okay, now, supporting the Backstreet Boys, there is some footage of you guys backstage.
Gosh.
So we want to have a look at what you were like then before the big time really back. Have a look at this.
Brilliant. Mark?
Yeah?
Yay! Right. Me and Mark here, you know, we're at Backstreet Boys backstage. This is actually one of their toilets. You know, so like, We're in the toilet there while it was great. We're after meeting boys and his manager Louis Walsh. And we got a big ride up in the hurdle, and we're after meeting all the boys. They're all dead off. We've met Kevin yet.
But the rest of them are sound.
Yeah, we're chatting them all out. They're dead on. We're going to meet the Howie and all the boys after the show at their hotel, and we're going, party.
You know? We're going for a party with the Backstreet Boys?
So it's kind of weird, like it all happened in the last 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So we're going on in 40 minutes. And there are 6,000 people out there, and they're kind of like screaming. You can hear them from here if you can.
No, you can't.
But it's serious, so.
Oh! You've never seen that before?
I've never seen that, no. I don't know who filmed it. I've never seen that, no, but it's what was wrong with me in that VT? So we're going here, we're doing this. I think it was probably nerves, too excited nerves.
The extraordinary thing is that you had intended to be at that gig anyway, hadn't you?
I did, yeah. We'd actually camped out for tickets. It's a great story. Me, Keane and Mark were huge. Well, all the boys, we're huge Backstreet Boys fans. And then we heard they were coming to Ireland, Patrick's Day or whatever it was, and we camped out, like, outside Star Rockers in Sligo. I went down like 4 in the morning or whatever to wait for the tickets. Got the tickets, thought it was the best thing ever. Until obviously Louis called us that night. I remember being in a pub in Sligo. We were all out together and Louis called me saying, "You're supporting the Backstreet Boys next week." And I started crying. I just broke down. I absolutely broke down and started bawling my eyes out. And Gillian was there actually, funny enough. She was waitressing in the pub. And it was one of those kind of special moments that you'll never forget it, you know. You kind of thought, this could really happen, you know, this could be our chance, you know, and just to get to meet the Backstreet Boys would have been incredible, you know.
That would have been enough. You mentioned a very important person, Gillian. I mean, you weren't childhood sweethearts from the age of 12, but you knew each other from that.
Yeah, we did. We met around the same time I met Cian. We all kind of met together in the fun company with Mary. Mary used to put on loads of different productions, and we were all in the fun company, so we used to go to the dance classes and do the musicals, and that's where I met Gillian, and, you know, it was... 12, yeah, we were about 12. But we did go out. We did go out for... I thought it was a few weeks, but she said it was 3 months. when we were 13, we did. And then it all ended terribly, you know. But, yeah, 6 years later, then we were back together.
Louis was quite, I suppose, ruthless as a manager. He looked at the six of you and... He took his thumb and stuck it over an arbitrary face.
He did. We met Louis for the first time in the Pod nightclub, and he told us bring the CD along and stuff like that. And he'd obviously heard about us, but this was after the phone call with my mum. And we met him, yeah, and he goes, "Six is too many." He just put his thumb over one of the lads' faces, and we kind of thought, right, this is going to be... We knew straight away he's going to be ruthless. So, and I remember going home then. We went home to Sligo, we all met the lads, we had a chat, and it was like, "Look, lads, there's chances there some of us aren't going to make it." We thought one of us might not make it.
Yeah.
Are we all willing to kind of go ahead with this, you know, because it could become difficult. And we did, you know, we all knew the chance we were taking, you know.
But difficult afterwards, I'm sure, when three of you go on to, you didn't know at that point it was going to be great, great things, but you were going somewhere.
Yeah.
And three had to be left behind.
It was very difficult because we were very close friends, and I was very close with Derek. Derek Lacey at the time, and he was like my best friend, you know, so to have to kind of have that conversation and all the lads, nobody wanted to tell anybody who was first to go, you know, but we had the conversation in my house, and you know, one of the most difficult things I've had to do, you know, because you're telling a friend, sorry, you know, it's not for you.
It almost wasn't for you either. That first audition with Simon Cowell, he didn't like the cut of your jib. And not alone that, you brought it on yourself.
I did. Actually, I'm going to blame Gillian on this one because, yeah, I did. I did a very bad audition. I was out the night before. I wasn't in great shape and arrived up, and Louis saw it straight away. But we went in and we met this man called Simon Cowell for the first time. And it was, yeah, it didn't go well, and Louis wasn't very happy with me afterwards. Because he kind of lost it when he came out of the interview, or out of the first audition.
He actually slapped you.
He slapped me in the face, yeah, and it was really... But it was crazy. I was coming out, going next, he goes, what are you doing? And he was shaking me, and he was like, I was counting on you in there, you know, and I was like, oh my God. And I thought my life was over. I thought that's it, I've ruined my life, I can't believe it, and it was horrible. He goes, don't worry, I've got a plan. So he basically, he dyed my hair blonde, and grew it long for about 3 or 4 months, and he said, we'll get him back, he won't even recognise you. And I was like, of course he's going to recognise me. And he was like, he won't recognise you. Louis always says, trust me. So, and he didn't, which was great, thank God.
This was the real beginning, because, I mean, yeah. Simon with Louis, I mean, the two of them are a very formidable force.
Of course.
But with Westlife on the verge of releasing their debut single, things were about to change in your life beyond your wildest dreams.
I want to know, whoever told you I was letting go.
In May of 1999, Westlife's first single, Swear It Again, went to number one in the UK charts and stayed there for 2 weeks. It was an extraordinary debut. By October the following year, they'd released 6 more singles. Every one of them went straight to number one. But if I
let you go. When Simon signed Westlife, he was on the phone to me every single day. And every day we were getting songs, we were making videos, we were building the band's profile, we were working it from day one. It was never going to fail with Simon.
During my time at Top of the Pops, Westlife were on the show so often, I thought I was going to have to invite them on the staff outing, you know. It was crazy, you know. They might as well have brought sleeping bags and stayed there, because it was single after single after single. Every single one went to number one.
We do hit after hit after hit. Everywhere they go, people love them. We're onto a great thing. I'll always
look back. In March 2004, just 3 weeks before the start of the turnaround tour, Brian announced he was leaving the band. Famously, Take That had fallen apart when Robbie Williams left. Was Westlife now about to suffer the same fate?
When Brian left, they really did think it was the end of the road.
And the fans weren't the only ones to be distraught.
We've enjoyed some unbelievable times with you throughout the years, and always hold you and them very close to our hearts. Excuse me.
They thought it was all over that night. They were so stressed. They were crying. They were so emotional. I'll never forget it. But it was the one night where I said, no, we're going to do it. We don't need Brian. And we didn't need Brian. They worked harder. They became a better band. And they made more money. They didn't have to pay Brian. You raised me
up. What happened next surpassed even Louis' expectations. In October 2005, Westlife released You Raise Me Up. It would knock the mighty Robbie Williams off the number one spot and completely revitalize the band. On the back of it, they signed a new record deal and went on to break Australia and China. Over the next 8 years, Westlife would release 5 best-selling albums and perform 7 concert tours, sealing their reputation as one of the greatest boy bands of all time. What about now?
I mean, what a fantastic experience for you to go from the first hit and then just see it grow and grow and grow. Yeah. And moving on then to the moment when Brian says, I want out of here. Did you think this is the end? The band can't survive Brian going.
It was, obviously a load of emotions go through your mind in the instant, like, but when he left, you know, I kind of like Louis said there, like, you know, we kind of, to a certain degree, I kind of stood up and I kind of got angry at him. To a certain degree, I was like, look, there's still four of us. You know, we don't need Brian. If he wants to leave, let him leave. You know, he's not going to spoil our dreams. You know, and I don't know, I just kind of, because everyone was distraught. Like, some of us were crying. Some of us were like, Nicky was just shocked. He was like, you know, Keane was head down. It was a real, you felt like your whole life is about to fall apart. And I was like, you know, no, it's not going to fall apart.
And what was Louis' attitude? Was he the one who immediately saw the silver?
He was like, I'm on the way over in the car. And he was breaking red lights all the way over to the north side. And he was flying across in the car. And when he got there, he kind of came in and goes, it's okay, we don't need him. If he wants to leave, let him leave. He's not gonna spoil it or whatever. But, you know, he said, you know, he makes a joke. When you get into a situation, Louis will always try and break the ice a bit. So he said, look, there was only four in the Beatles. And we were like, oh, whatever, you know, like, it wasn't a funny comment. Then he goes, look, you can only fit four in a taxi.
One of the things that surprised me, I've been reading in your book, is that you guys, you kind of lost the run of yourselves a bit sometimes.
Sometimes,
you know,
yeah.
Bad behaviour, which we don't associate with Westlife at all.
Like, oh, totally, yeah, you know, yeah. We did have a pint once or twice and all that. Yeah. That was our thing. You know, we'd have a drink. You know, we were never into drugs. You know, none of us ever got messed up on that. And, you know, we were always kind of very straight-laced, you know. But we liked having a drink, we liked having a pint. And it was our way to unwind because it was just crazy. You know, our world was crazy. And outside of our hotel, we couldn't really go anywhere. It was our only kind of
So you lived in a bubble?
We lived in a bubble, but together we enjoyed that bubble. And then after work, we went and had a drink and enjoyed our time together. Because we were close friends as well. At the start of the band, we were young kids and playing 10 nights in Wembley on our first tour. It was just mind-boggling.
Did that kind of stuff, though, ever affect your performances and your work?
For me, like a couple of times, yeah. A couple of times, you know, I might have had maybe one or two too many. There was one night I was really sick because I was out very late with Keane the night before. We were out very, very late in the morning and got in the next day. And I had a bucket beside the stage. And it was in Sheffield, so sorry if anyone didn't like that show. It was in Sheffield Arena, one of four or five nights we were playing there. And I was really sick. But it was funny, when you got on stage and you heard the fans, you heard the crowd hit you like a wave, it just goes out the window. Whether you have a pain in your head, you're having a bad day, whatever, that kind of hysteria for like an hour and a half, you just, everything goes out the window. And I was fine. I was fine after two songs.
How did Louis cope with this? I mean, was he a hard taskmaster?
He was. We had just had seven number ones and we thought, you know, I suppose we would have lost the run of ourselves as individuals, as a band, and maybe demanding a little bit here and there and stuff like that. And Louis was having none of it. Like, he fired us a couple of times. He goes, you're fired. And we're like, he kept telling us we're very lucky guys. You're very lucky. You know, I know. He'd also say, he used to say, there's only four in the Beatles. You know, he'd slag us. One of you, I'll just let you go, you know. But then when there was four of us, there's only three in the Bee Gees. You know, he used to say that. And, you know, he was great, but he was very strict.
All right, well, with Westlife's absolutely enormous success, it looked to everybody that you were living the high life. I mean, that was the appearance from outside, but investments outside the music business meant that everything wasn't quite as wonderful for you as it seemed, and we'll maybe talk about that after the break.
Okay.
Welcome back to In the Round from the Round Room in Dublin's famous Mansion House. Before the break, we were talking to tonight's guest, one quarter of Westlife, Shane Filan, about the band's success. And things were going really well, and there was a lot of money swilling around the place. So you made some investments, early investments in the property business, which went actually quite well.
Yeah, at the start, probably 2003, maybe 2003, I bought a few houses, like investment rental properties. Because you know, we were very lucky. We'd made a lot of money for our age. You know, we were whatever 23, 24 years old, and we'd done quite well the first 4 or 5 years at Westlife. But you know, kind of Brian had just left. Gillian was pregnant with Nicole, so I thought, you know, this might not last forever. I got to invest some of this money, and I didn't know much about investments, if I've been honest. I was very scared of going near shares. Yeah. You know, because everyone thought, oh, he could lose it all. And I thought, well, I'm not going near shares. So I went through property instead.
Bricks and mortar.
Bricks safe. And mortar, yeah, you're safe. And that was kind of the general consensus, you know, bricks and mortar is safe. And everybody I kind of seemed to be doing it that had made some money was putting it into...
And you made some money on those initial houses that they upped in value very rapidly.
So, yeah, I bought five houses and they went up $500,000 in a year. So I'd made $100,000 on each house in a year. So I thought, this is where I should put my money.
OK, well, it's sometimes hard even now to remember exactly how the nation behaved. I mean, the euphoria of the Celtic Tiger. So we're going to go back now and remember the madness.
In 2001, Ireland felt like the best place in the world to be young and rich.
Really, the entire economy was focused around property, development, real estate. These were the easy ways to make money.
Shane had a helicopter, his wife had a Bentley, he had a beautiful house.
At the time, it wasn't just individuals who were losing the run of themselves, it was a country that had, as a whole, lost the run of itself.
There was helicopters everywhere. It was like LA.
Shane invested a fortune in property development. Back then, it seemed less of a gamble and more like a sure thing. By 2006, he had his dream home in Sligo and an extensive portfolio of residential and commercial projects. Things just couldn't get any better. And they didn't.
So, the crash came. Now, you had done a lot of stuff with your brother Finbar, and therefore we had the company Shay, as in Shane, and Finn, as in Finbar. Yeah. What sort of things were you investing in?
Well, the first thing we did together, as I said, you know, I bought the houses, and initially we were kind of, Finbar was getting involved, because he was an engineer, so he was offered a job in Belgium, and he kind of didn't want to go. You know, and I thought, well, look, why don't we try and, you know, the property market seems to be really good, why don't we try and do some of this and invest into this? And the first thing we did was a housing development in Drumahair, which got off to a really good start. You know, it's the first day we sold 29 houses. So we thought, you know, we got a great building firm in. We tried to get the best of everything involved. Obviously, we had to go to get loans off the bank. The bank thought it was a great idea. And so we did it, you know, we all did it together. And the first development went really well. And then it kind of just...
Everything stopped.
It just literally stopped.
I mean, that graph we showed you there. That graph we showed you there was demonstrative of how quickly everything fell.
Yeah, it fell very quickly, and it was really, it was a very, very scary time, you know, because I was in deep, I suppose, at that stage, you know.
Now, you had got a number of development sites and applied for permissions, and they didn't come, and there were all sorts of obstacles in your way, but you kept on looking for one that would go and go more quickly.
Yeah, that was kind of the issue, you know. I think we had bought that site and started developing it, and then a field came up behind my house that I was just finishing. I just built a nice house, obviously, and I spent 4 years building it. And a field came up two fields behind it. And that's when it really went wrong, because they had just got planning permission for a 15-storey hotel across the road from this field. And there was rumours of, you know, two towers coming into the town and big entrance gates into Sligo nearly. But this, you know, I thought, if this is built behind my house is ruined. So I thought, I need to try and buy this field. And it was expensive, it was very expensive, because it was literally a 4-acre field with cows eating grass on it, but it cost $2.5 million. So I thought, look, we can build a supermarket on it and just sell it off and it'll pay for itself. So I thought it'd be pretty cool, you know, for the village.
So your borrowings at this point on your various projects, some of which were being frustrated by slow planning and so on.
Yeah.
How much did you owe the banks?
Probably around 10 million, I'd say, at that stage I was probably in for. Because I'd personally guaranteed them, and that was the whole problem. The problem was the planning took so long. You know, we had the housing development, but that had planning permission, so that was easier. Whereas this was a brand new site in Carrow, and it took nearly 4 years to get planning. In and out, different objections, a lot of people objecting to it. It felt like it was never going to be built, and nobody wanted me to build anything. You know, it did feel like that at one stage.
Now, at one point, Westlife decided to take a year off. Now, you needed the money coming in all the time. So what did that do to you?
That was a really scary year. That was probably the worst year in the band, nearly, for me. Because, in fairness, we needed a break. You know, we'd done 9 albums in 9 years. So it was something that we badly needed as a band. Because, you know, you're very close in the band, but you're also nearly too close at times, and you need to get away from each other. But that meant also no earnings that year. So I kind of ran out of money that year. And it was a very scary time.
And yet nobody knew.
Nobody knew. The boys knew I had investments, but I'd never told them anything more than that. I talked to my dad a lot about it, you know, because he was just great to talk to. You know, Dad's like he's like one of my best friends, you know, and I can tell him anything. And he was very supportive, you know. My mum was too, but, you know, when you have a dad-son chat, it's just different.
At this point, we know that the banks were calling in loans on everybody who had given personal guarantees.
Yeah.
You were trying to fund interest. I mean, what was the most interest you had to pay every month, would you say?
It was 60 or 70,000 a month, you know, and one month it was like 96,000. You know, and that's like a Friday at the end of April. And I was just trying to keep these at bay because there was, you know, there was probably three or four sites at this stage, and I was just hoping for one of them, if one of these could be built. And I didn't want to build them to live in them. I wanted to build them to sell them. You know, we'd some great sites. We had a nursing home site, we had a couple of neighbourhood centres for like a big supermarket. So, and supermarkets were, a couple of them were needed, and they're still needed in Sligo. But yeah, we just couldn't get the planning permission. It just took too long.
So in your day job with Westlife, you're earning all this money and you're generating lots of cash, and it's going straight to the banks.
It was coming in and basically going out, because I used to dread Mondays. Every Mondays you get the emails from the banks and saying, you know, you owe us 3.7 million and we need it paid by in the next 28 days, and you're thinking, you know, I didn't, at that stage I might have had 50 grand or 100 grand. I was waiting for the next installment of Westlife money to come in, which was always there. You know, Westlife were still very successful, so still earning money.
Who advised you, or maybe you didn't take any advice, about signing personal guarantees? Or was there no choice in those days?
There was no choice.
Banks were flinging money at everybody.
Yeah, the banks were giving out money, like they were. They were giving, look, I was 26 years old. I had absolutely no experience in the property market. But they were happy to give me out millions of euro because they thought the projects were good, just like I did. You know, everybody thought they were good. They wouldn't have given me that kind of money to a 26-year-old guy that knows nothing about property unless they thought it was good. But, yeah, unfortunately, you had to sign personal guarantees or they wouldn't give you the money. And if I didn't sign the personal guarantee on this one, I wouldn't fix this problem.
From the time you started Chafin and the initial investments and the bank throwing money at you to the point where the banks are now chasing you and the ban takes a year off, what was that timeline?
It's about a four-year timeline, maybe 4.5 years. So it went from everyone being very happy to everyone being very, you know, not happy at me. 2009 was a horrible year.
How did you cope with, you know, how the mighty are fallen? I'm sure there were some people, not alone in Sligo, but in the greater world, who were saying, aha, there's your man, used to be worth millions, now look at him. I mean, how did you bear that particular...
It was difficult. Of course, there was people that didn't like me and maybe in general. Sligo was my hometown, you know. So there was an awful lot of people. I love Sligo, you know, and I get 99% support there, I think. You know, I really do.
Have you left some people financially bruised in Sligo?
Of course there was. Of course there was, you know. Mainly it was banks, but there was other people obviously involved, creditors and different deals you go into. In a business venture that we take together, that everybody takes together. And sometimes business doesn't work out, you know. And for me, it was never anything personal. And, you know, certain people might feel that way towards me, but it was never anything personal for me. It was business and it didn't work out. And I lost, they lost, we all lost. I didn't make anything from Chafin, and I lost everything. So it's not like, I'm great now, because I'm not. So I think that's an important thing to kind of to say, you know, we all lost in this.
Do you resent the banks for giving you the money so easily and then being so...
No, I don't resent them, because at the time they're doing their job, they think it's a great idea. But at the end, the way it all went at the end, you know, I felt like it was quite unfair, and it was very public, which was the worst part about it, because I was in a band called Westlife and it was a huge story, and it was, you know, I was dragged through the papers a lot. But, you know, I expected it was going to be, but, you know, I don't know. It's a hard one to...
All right, well, with the situation with Chafin coming to a head, the last thing you needed at that time was to lose your day job with Westlife. But that's what was going to happen, right. And we'll talk about that after the break. ¶¶ Welcome back to the Mansion House here in Dublin. I'm in conversation with Shane Filan of Westlife. Now, Shane, I mentioned the prospect of losing the day job when the band decided to call it a day. What did that do to you? Because you knew that what had been a source of kind of solving your problems was going to be no more.
Very, very, very scared is probably the one thing. Because, as a band, Pat, we knew it wasn't... when we took the year off, it was great. We came back, it was What About Now, the year. The album was fantastic, that song was amazing. Still one of my favourite songs. And we had a lot of fun for another year or so. And then we kind of went back to feeling the same way, where we just felt like it wasn't good enough anymore. We didn't enjoy it as much anymore. We even felt the fans were not enjoying it as much, that we weren't giving them, a good enough songs. And we felt like, the one thing we always said when we started, we'll go out on top, we'll go out on a high, we'll never let it dwindle. Because Westlife was too special to do that. When it came near the end, it was a decision that was coming for probably at least 2 years. And we talked about it a million times, but eventually it had to come.
So you embark on a farewell tour, and in the middle of all of this, you discover that the news is going to break, that you are going to be, I suppose, humiliated a little bit.
Oh, totally, totally. I remember getting the call from Joanne, my PR girl, and she said, look, there's a big story breaking tomorrow. It was around Easter time, and it's about all your financial stuff. Because at this stage now, I had the boys didn't know, Louis didn't know, nobody really knew. And I suppose that was my biggest fear, that I'd had such a good life. I've been very lucky to be in, obviously, Westlife and do what we did. And it was kind of coming to the end of the band. I was like, oh, it's just going to be such a black mark on all this now, And the band were getting on really well at the time. We were really enjoying it. We were obviously looking forward to the big shows that we were going to do. But it came out around Easter and it kind of just hit like a bombshell. And it was everything. All the documents were leaked, which was really... still can't understand it, but they were leaked to the papers, everything to do with my IVA, which I was trying to approach the banks and try and work something out with
it. Knowing it was going to break, did you tell Louis, did you tell the lads?
Yeah, I actually didn't tell the lads. I told Louis, obviously around my mum and dad, said, look, it's all the IVA, the thing I was applying for with the banks to try and, arrange something with them to kind of work forward. All them details, so every detail about every single debt I had, everything I owned, the value of my wedding ring, it was down to everything. It was like a bankruptcy document. Everything was in the paper the next day. My whole life was just splashed in the paper, which wasn't nice. It was actually, I think it was the week before Easter Sunday.
In the middle of all of this, you're trying to cope with all of this, but you're also on the farewell tour, and of course the climax of that was a couple of nights in Croke Park where you had to say goodbye to the fans, and it really was an emotional farewell.
In June 2012, at the end of a farewell tour, Westlife went out on a high with two huge concerts at Croke Park. After 14 incredible years, Shane Filan had many people to thank for his success, but he saved the best for last.
The most important person in this stadium tonight is my beautiful wife, Gillian. Gillian, I've loved you since the day I saw you for the first time. We were only 12 years old. And it took me a long time to get you eventually, but I got you. And you've stuck by me so well, I can't describe how much I love you. It's just, you've kept me focused no matter what happens in our life. You've given me three beautiful, healthy children. And that's all we need, babe. That's all we need. I love you.
Westlife's farewell tour grossed an estimated €27 million, but Shane wouldn't see one red cent of that. By now, he was deep in debt.
I knew Shane wasn't himself. What I thought it was because the band were breaking up. I did not know. He never told me about all the financial problems he had. He kept all that to himself. I don't know how he did it. I really don't know how he did it, because it was an awful lot of pressure on somebody so young.
With the property crash, the banks had called in their loans. Shane's developments were in meltdown, leaving him facing personal debts of €23 million.
15 years with 14 number one hits, all that huge career behind him. owing 23 million. If you read it in a novel, you would say that's too far-fetched, too unbelievable to be true.
Having lost their dream home in Sligo, Shane moved his family to England, where he declared bankruptcy.
He was devastated because he was letting his family down, because he had now had young children, he had a wife and young children to support, and he'd made a decision that had gone horribly wrong. And I think, had he not had Gillian, it might be a different story from today. I would hold you in my arms,
I would take the pain away. Gillian stood by him, like, Gillian is always and will always be there for Shane.
He was very lucky to have met Gillian, because she was nothing short of a solid rock when all this trouble started, financial trouble. He was blessed to have her.
You know, from the first time we met, I know we were inseparable. So in love from day one that I knew no matter what we went through, that we would survive. We have brought these three amazing kids into the world, and I think I'm very lucky to have found somebody like him. And I'm lucky that my kids have a dad like him.
I suspect we couldn't have got through it at all without Gillian's help.
Definitely not. No. It was, she's just unreal, you know? She's just, she's class.
Another woman might have decided enough is enough. You've been an idiot. You've lost us the money. You've destroyed our prosperity.
It could, yeah. It could have, but not Gillian, no. Not Gillian, but it could have been, you know. I could have been very unlucky to meet somebody else that would have reacted completely differently. And she was, you know, it's cliche to say you're rock, but she was. She was like, you know, she was like a boulder. You know, there was nothing that was going to stop us. Like, I remember telling her at the time, when we knew it was really bad, and I said to her, look, I remember I was standing in the house in Sligo, and I said, we could lose this house. It's not looking good. And she goes, I don't care. We could live in a cardboard box. You know, and that's the type of woman she was. You know, that was her comment. And I thought, oh my God, you know, like, that's when, you know, that's when you realize, Pat, you know, life's going to throw some ups and downs at you. You know, if you have a happy family, and three perfect children, you know, I don't need anything else. You know, you just need to get by, but I don't
Did
need much
she
more.
Never recriminate with you at all. Never kind of
give out to me.
Yeah.
No, she never did, actually. She never did. You know, she knew it was bad, and I talked her through it, obviously. And but she was like, you know what? At the time, it was the right thing to do. If somebody said, you know, you could put the shoe in the other foot and go, if you had made money and the property thing went really well, they'd be saying, why didn't you invest in property? You know, you would have secured your future forever. Because that's all I was trying to do. I wasn't trying to become rich. I already was rich for my age. You know, I was very wealthy at the time. So it wasn't out of greed. It was more out of protection, because you're 26, 27 years old. Like, even if you have a lot of money, it's not going to last forever. You know, and you have to say, how will I protect the future?
Was it to prepare for the post-Westlife period of your life?
I mean, yeah, it was funny because I never thought, funny enough, I never really wanted to go solo. You know, I never actually wanted to go solo. And the thought of the end of Westlife, I was thinking, that would be it. I was in Westlife and that was incredible. And now I have some investments now that have looked after the future. So I can do something maybe just that I enjoy. I didn't know if it was going to be singing until I realised at the end, obviously, I have to sing. That's what I have to do.
How bad was it? I mean, did you literally lose everything?
Yeah.
Everything?
Like everything, yeah. Like everything bar... Everything, actually, yeah. You know, it was really bad, you know. Like, right after, we just played Croke Park, you know, and you saw the footage there. It's incredible looking back at it. Like, and we'd played to 170,000 people in one weekend. And, like, the following week, I had a few hundred quid. I'd literally had a few hundred quid in my bank account. And it was funny because, you know, It was a really tough kind of few weeks and even months after that, because I didn't know how. I had no job and I had no money, but I had three small children. And obviously I was going to get you know, some money through the trustee eventually to kind of, for living expenses and stuff. Obviously, you go through a whole legal process.
This is the bankruptcy in the
yes,
UK.
Yes, so the bankruptcy, and then you'll have a post period after bankruptcy for like 3 years. And
that trustee and you have an ongoing relationship until the period expires.
Yeah, basically, yeah, which is about another year after now. So it's still going on. So I'm still giving a lot of my income to the trustee, and that goes to the creditors, and people get money out of that or whatever. Whether it's £2 or £20 million, there's no limit. There was no cap on it. So I felt that was, you know, that was fair, and that's the way we worked through it. But it was very scary because I didn't even have a record deal at the time. You know, it was Louis. I had Louis. I had Gillian and my family, obviously, but I had Louis and myself, and that was it. And Louis was determined to make a success of it. You know, we'll get a record deal, we'll get great songs, and, you know, I had great fans as well. You know, I really had some unbelievable fans. The support I got from the anticipation from day one was just immense.
Did the children have any awareness of what you were going through, or did you manage to protect them from that?
You know, they would have seen me. I think Nicole was definitely more, she would have seen me upset a bit, you know, the odd time here and there. But, you know, I kept it from them. The one thing I had to do was protect them from all that. And that was one thing I worried about. But, you know, because, you know, we're obviously from Sligo, and, you know, one of the local papers in Sligo was, I was front page of it like every other week. And it was all my fall from grace, my doom and gloom. And I was always afraid when I, you know, came back to Sligo, she'd pick up the paper. Like, there'd be a picture of our house on the front of it. Yeah. You know, and she'd be like, that's our house, you know, because at the time I told her the roof was broken. That, like, what else do you say? You don't say, sorry, you've lost your house, you know, because that's what we had. We were just obviously forced out of your house, you know. So I had to lie to her to a certain degree, but you have to do things to protect your kids, and you do anything to protect your children and protect their kind of memories, you know, and it was difficult at times in Sligo, but, you know, it was, we got through it.
Post-Westlife phase in your life, you intended to be maybe in gentle retirement, perhaps in property development, who knows, but you didn't intend to be solo.
No.
But you've had to do it, and I suspect you've enjoyed the last couple of years as you've had the first album, and now the second is going into the studio.
Yeah.
Were you worried that the fans who'd loved you as one-fifth and then a quarter of Westlife mightn't find you so endearing as a solo performer?
As appealing, yeah. Of course, yeah, I was very worried about that. You know, because they hadn't heard anything. Nobody had heard anything for like a year, you know, before it came out. So, to say the least, I was a little bit nervous and anxious about it. Yeah, I was absolutely... The build-up was horrendous, nearly. But I knew they were very excited, you know. Westlife had an amazing fan base, and stuck with us the whole way through. They kind of grew up with us, you know, and we had that fan base that just kind of... I knew I'd get some support, but I knew I had to deliver something that was also great, because they go, well, that's not good enough. And that's what I was afraid of. But I said, look, I can only do my best, and I'm still working out my sound. I'm still working out... It takes a while. Coming out of a band like Westlife, you know, I think now I'm really starting to find, on this album so far, I'm starting to find what Shane Filan's sound should be like, do you know? It's more pop, it's more... I'm singing a few more ballads on this, which I love to sing. I love singing big, powerful songs. But yeah, they were amazing. Like, even the concerts, like the first night in Liverpool, I just never forget it. Like, I never forget, my mouth was so dry, and I was coming out to, you know, 2,000 people, but it was Croke Park to me. You're walking out to this place packed, Liverpool Philharmonic Hall, and I walked out, and the reaction, it was just like... I was like, oh my God, I'm going to be okay. And I felt that. I felt that in an instant, I'm going to be okay. You know, this is going to be fun.
Going back to the possibility of someday a Westlife reunion, do you think that might be on the cards? Actually, before you answer that, have a look at this.
They were a brilliant band to work with. And who knows? Maybe in a few years they'll be back. I would love that.
That would be great. Will they be back?
Of course. They don't know it yet, but yeah. Of course. Of course.
So, according to Louis, you don't know it yet, but it's going to happen.
I think Louis, you know, Louis was the most devastated fan when it all happened. He's like, no! You know, Pat, it's a question we get asked a lot. And it's, you know, it's something that could happen. It's something that also could not happen. You know, because... it's four or five people or whatever that have to make that decision. So if one person doesn't want to do it, it doesn't happen. So it depends where we all are individually at our own lives at that stage. But, you know, it could happen, of course. But, you know, we'll have to wait and see on that one if Louis's dream comes true.
And I'm afraid that's all we have time for, Shane. Thank you very much for being with us in the round. And may I wish you the very best of luck with the new album, which will be with us later this year.
Thanks, Pat. Cheers. Thank you.
Daniel and Magella O'Donnell. Until then, from all of us here, a very good night.